Welcome to One-on-One. I'm Steve Adubato. Wounds are things people think they know about, but we have someone in the house. The doctor's in the house to tell us all we need to know about wounds. He is Dr. Asaad Samra, who is medical director at the Center for Wound Healing at Bayshore Community Hospital, part of the Meridian Health System, right?
That is correct.
Doctor, talk to us about wounds, and what's the difference between I hate to call it a regular wound versus a chronic wound?
So we break them down between acute wounds versus chronic wounds. And an acute wound would be a wound that basically just happened. And typically speaking, an acute wound would heal within a few days, potentially, or within a few weeks. Once a wound has gone beyond about a 4 to 6 week period of time, we then call it a chronic wound. There are people that were more disposed to having a chronic wound, perhaps those with diabetes or some immune problem, maybe those that are bedridden and therefore are constantly putting pressure on an area. When a wound is in a chronic stage, we need to figure out why it's in a chronic stage and then try to bring it back into a more appropriate wound healing capacity.
But go back to the diabetes question. There's a member of the United States Congress who represents New Jersey, Congressman Donald Payne. We just had him on our sister program, Capital Report, who's been dealing with a chronic wound, who has diabetes, and he's talked about it publicly, so there are no confidentiality issues. And he's been very public about the fact that's an issue. What is the correlation between diabetes and a chronic wound?
I appreciate the question, Steve. It really is the fact that diabetes results in a high blood sugar in the bloodstream. That high blood sugar affects the ability for the body to heal. In addition to that, specifically in the feet, it can affect the ability to feel, and therefore people can result in having small scrapes or cuts in their feet and not even know about it. And therefore they're now walking, for example, outside with an open wound, unaware of it, that wound gets infected, and then by the time it becomes aware of, or the patient becomes aware of it, they have a much more significant problem. Diabetes, as you know, is a major issue in our country. Almost 30 million people have diabetes, as the statistics show of 2014. And so we're seeing a lot of people coming to our wound care center with wounds, and they're not healing because they're diabetic.
Let's do this. We're about to talk about hyperbaric oxygen therapy, right?
Correct.
And I know about this because the doctor and I have worked together before. I don't want to disclose this. I've done a whole range of leadership training, in fact, actually for physicians at Meridian for the last couple of years, and so I've learned a little bit about this, but we're about to show some photos as you talk about this. Exactly what is this therapy and why is it so important as we look at these photos right now? What is this and who's a candidate for it?
So in our Center for Wound Healing at Bayshore Hospital, we have two hyperbaric oxygen chambers, and essentially a patient who has perhaps a diabetic foot ulcer that with a significant infection, maybe involving the bone, for example, that would be a situation where we would want to, in addition to the wound care, do some hyperbaric oxygen therapy.
Why?
Because by putting them in the chamber, we increase that chamber's pressure with 100% oxygen. That forces oxygen into their bloodstream, and now at a higher concentration of oxygen in the bloodstream, their body can fight the infection that's in the bone, for example, and help heal that wound faster.
But doctor, who's a candidate for that chamber, and who is someone who you say, you don't belong in there?
So there can be medical reasons. Perhaps their heart can't take that pressure or their lungs can't take that pressure. And if they can't take the pressure, then it's not safe for them to be in the chamber. Other examples would be wounds that are not appropriate. So if I was to have a bad, even car accident for that example, and have a bad cut on my leg, maybe with an open wound component to it, that's still an acute wound. We wouldn't necessarily want to treat that with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. We would want to treat that with more traditional modalities first. Typically speaking, it has to be a very significant infection or part of the body where there isn't appropriate blood flow. And we've now reestablished blood flow, and we want to, in addition to the reestablished blood flow, put more oxygen into that area.
So, but doctor, if it's in your foot or your leg, why are you putting the whole body into the chamber?
Good question. Just putting the foot into a chamber and pressurizing oxygen there, the oxygen does not seep into the skin. It actually has to go into your lungs, and then through your lungs, it'll go into your bloodstream and then flow throughout your entire body.
Okay, but I'm thinking to myself, okay, you go in the chamber once, and it deals with it? Do you go in multiple times?
Right, so it's actually a pretty significant commitment on the part of the patient. It's an every day for about 4 to 6 weeks, and each treatment is about 2 hours. So it's a significant commitment on the patient. It takes us about 5 to 6 dives, as we call them, to actually get that blood oxygen level high enough where we feel that we're making an impact. And then that sustained period of that 4 to 6 weeks results in those positive outcomes that we see.
Why is it that seniors, people who are just a bit older, or maybe I'm wrong about this, they tend to have more chronic wounds?
You're absolutely correct.
Or is there that correlation?
Yeah, that correlation is correct. And some of the most recent scientific literature showing that we have something in our body called a mesenchymal stem cell.
What is it?
A mesenchymal stem cell.
Which is?
And the mesenchymal stem cell actually is almost like the traffic cop during a wound healing situation, telling the different cells what to do and where to go and how to heal the wound. What we find is that when we're born, we have a significant number, millions of mesenchymal stem cells. And as we get older, that number steadily decreases. In addition to that, if you have some comorbid conditions like diabetes, end-stage renal disease, hypertension, that also negatively affects your mesenchymal stem cell count, in addition to perhaps affecting the blood flow or sugar issues, as we had talked about, that affect the capillaries. So you're absolutely correct. There is a higher proportion of wounds that we see in the older population, especially because we tend to develop diseases as we get older as well.
Final question. Can we prevent certain wounds?
100%. One of the things that I think is paramount is constantly checking your feet if you're a diabetic.
Checking your feet?
Looking in between your toes, looking at the bottom of your feet.
For what? Cracks? What?
Exactly. Any cracks or minor injuries that you would not have noticed otherwise because of not having good sensation in your feet. That in and of itself could prevent a significant portion of the diabetic foot ulcers we see.
You're doing important work, doctor.
Thank you.
And I have a sense that there's a lot of misconceptions and misunderstandings about wounds, and you helped clarify a lot of that. Dr. Asaad Samra, who is, by the way, comes from a great family. Anyone else in your family in the medical field?
My father and my brother are both plastic surgeons, and we're in practice together.
Well, you're all doing great work. Dr. Asaad Samra, medical director at the Center for Wound Healing at Bayshore Community Hospital, part of the Meridian Health System. Thank you so much, Asaad. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
One-on-One will continue right after this. Stay with us.
One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating over 25 years of broadcast excellence. Funding for this edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been provided by the New Jersey Education Association, Choose New Jersey, New Jersey Sharing Network, New Jersey Resources, Wells Fargo, QualCare Inc., and by Johnson & Johnson. Promotional support provided by NJ.com, Small News, Big News, True Jersey, and by NJ Biz, All Business, All New Jersey. Transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.